Good morning. Welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church of Carbondale, Illinois. It's going to be a great day of worship. A little later on, we get to introduce you to a new staff member here at First who will be working with youth and young adults as well as coordinating with our family ministry. We're also starting a new sermon series today called No Fair, Thank Goodness. You know, Jesus has a different idea about fairness than we do, but thank goodness, because if we got what we deserve, that would not be so good. The fact is that instead of getting what we deserve, which would be judgment, we've been offered grace. Instead of exiled, we've been reconciled. So instead of giving judgment, Jesus invites us to offer grace to one another. So today we have a very practical teaching from Jesus about how to reconcile with someone who has offended you. We are going to invite you to let us know that you're in worship today. On our website, there's a link called Connection Card, and it asks you three or four quick questions just to let us know you're worshiping with us. If you're on watching on Facebook, you can click one of those emojis, like a little heart emoji or something, and let us know, lets us know you're here. But we would ask a special favor of those who are able to do this, to go to YouTube this week and subscribe. So if you are not a subscriber to our YouTube channel, to find a moment to do that, you go to YouTube, you search for First United Methodist Church Carbondale, and you'll find us if you use those words, and then click subscribe when you see our church and our channel. We have about 50 subscribers right now, but if we can get that number up closer to 100, that sort of opens some YouTube doors to us, so we'd appreciate your help. Let's turn our attention now to our call to worship, which Darren Bailey will be bringing us.
We come together knowing we are a broken body. We know God delights in celebrating the things that make us different from each other, but we've allowed those things to bring dissension, duress, and division among us. Our lives, when not centered in Christ, tear not only ourselves apart, but rip into the very fabric of our community as a whole. As believers, we are called to be one mind, heart, and body through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Please join me in singing our opening hymn, Just As I Am Without One Plea, number 357.
Thank you.
O Lord, we come before you with the assurance that when two or more are gathered in your name, you are with us. Today, we trust that your presence not only connects across time and space, but connects us and makes us a community, though we are scattered. We lift up our hearts to you and ask that you purify them of any discourse against our fellow brothers and sisters. Draw us near to you, O God. Amen.
Before I hand things over to Miss Nisha for our children's message today, I want to introduce you to a new staff member here at First United Methodist Church. Catherine Bell is coming on board as our assistant pastor for youth, young adults, and she'll also be coordinating with our family ministries. So let's meet Catherine Bell, and I hope you'll find an opportunity to welcome her to the Carbondale First family.
Hi, everybody. I'm Catherine. I'm super excited to be joining First United Methodist Church. A little about me. I was raised in Coal City, Illinois, which is about 4.5 hours north of here. And I went to school at Olivet Nazarene University, where I received 2 degrees in children's ministry and youth ministry. I recently moved down to the area in August with my husband, David. He's a social studies teacher in Heron and also a football coach. We're both really excited to be joining your church community, and I can't wait to meet you all soon.
Well, thank you, Catherine, for introducing yourself to us. We'll be learning more about Catherine in the weeks to come, and she'll be sharing more with us and with our youth about the things that she is planning for our youth ministry for the fall. If this were normal time, we'd be having some kind of celebration to welcome Catherine to our staff. Since we are not able to do that right now, we do hope that you will send some kind of note or communication. Maybe you have a favorite restaurant in town. You want to send them a gift card or gift certificate so that they can experience that. Whatever it might be, we hope that you'll extend your warmest welcome to Catherine and David, who, by the way, are newlyweds, if she didn't mention that, just got married about a month ago. And so welcome them to town and welcome them to our church family. All right, let's turn things over to Miss Nisha. It's time for our children's message.
I have a balloon and a balloon inflator. Let's pretend that this balloon is a person. Let's see, let's name him Joe. And let's pretend that this inflator is all of the actions and words that hurt Joe's feelings. So what do you would think would happen if Joe's feelings keep getting hurt over and over again? That's right. Joe would go pop, kablooey, which means that this one balloon will suddenly become many different pieces of a balloon. In the Bible, Jesus is teaching his disciples that if one person gets their feelings hurt by another person, then they need to talk about how their feelings are. Jesus told his disciples how to talk to each other because he didn't want them to go pop. Obviously, the disciples are not balloons, but they aren't going to pop. But if they hurt each other's feelings, they might stop talking to each other, or stop working together, or even stop being friends and stay away from each other. That's not what Jesus wants. Jesus wants his disciples to know that they don't have to store up their feelings until they pop. Jesus is telling them to talk to each other when one of them has been hurt, no matter how bad the hurt is, because that's how they can stay together. Jesus says that whenever two or more of his disciples are together, Jesus will be there. In other words, Jesus knows that the best way for the disciples to be able to teach others what Jesus had taught them is if they stay together and work together. Jesus' disciples did what Jesus taught them. Sometimes they had difficult talks with each other, but by following Jesus' teachings, the disciples were able to stay together and share with others the same things that Jesus had taught them about God's love, forgiveness, and healing. The same things are still true for us today. When we follow Jesus' teachings, when we talk with those who hurt us and are honest with them, we are better able to stay together, work together, and stay friends, just like the disciples. Let's pray. Father God, sometimes we get angry. Our feelings are hurt by the things we say or do. And we do things that we don't really mean. Help us to do as Jesus taught, to talk to each other and make peace with one another. Thank you and amen.
Our scripture lesson today is Matthew 18, verses 15 through 20. If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you've regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If their member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly, I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. Here ends the reading.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God. You are our rock, our strength, and our redeemer. For today's sermon, I want to share a story written by Bishop Will Willimon. He wrote this at a time when he was still leading a congregation, and though I suspect the two people at the heart of this story were not real people, ask anyone who's been involved in church leadership at almost any level, and they will tell you that this story may not be real, but it's true. At first, she said she had never intended to hurt anyone's feelings. Alice said that when she was drawing up the list of leaders for the church's annual missions funding drive, she just thought some new leadership would be nice. So she left Anne's name off the list. But when it was brought to her attention that Anne had been hurt by being left out of the funding drive, Alice admitted that leaving Anne off the list was more intentional. Everyone is sick and tired of being ordered around by Anne. Her high-handed ways are getting on people's nerves. So I took it upon myself to let her sit this one out. Who was everyone? Some asked. Was it not true that our congregation led the district in funds raised for missions? Did not most people agree that this work really seemed to be Anne's special calling? At first, Anne responded the way her people often do. She quietly withdrew from activities that fall. She also began to talk to others about the funding drive, saying that it was going to fail, saying that Alice was ruining the church with her deceitful ways. Matters, as matters often do in the church, went from bad to worse. By the next spring, the church was clearly split into two camps. Those who were behind Alice and her plans for a revitalized church with different leadership, and those with Anne, who had been at the helm for the past 20 years and had held the church together through thick and thin. Anne took some pride that others had rallied behind her. Alice said that Anne's underhanded actions only proved how unsuitable she was for church leadership. So matters continued through the summer, and well might have continued forever, or until the church went through a full-scale division of the congregation. Then there was that Sunday in early September when George Mason, the lector, stood and read the appointed lesson, Matthew 18, 15 through 20. If a fellow believer hurts you, go and tell him. Work it out between the two of you. If he listens, you've made a friend. If he won't listen, take one or two others along so that the presence of witnesses will keep things honest, and try again. If he still won't listen, tell the church. If he won't listen to the church, you'll have to start over from scratch. Confront him again with the need for repentance and offer again God's forgiving love. Take this most seriously. A yes on earth is a yes in heaven. A no on earth is a no in heaven. What you say to one another is eternal. I mean this. When two of you get together on anything at all on earth and make a prayer of it, my Father in heaven goes into action. And when two or three of you are together because of me, you can be sure that I'll be there. Anne heard these words from Scripture and bolted upright where she was sitting. It was as if the words of Scripture had been addressed to her and only to her. She nervously looked around at other members of the congregation. Were they aware that the Bible this Sunday was speaking to her and just her? She had clearly been wronged by Alice. Everyone said so. Well, at least her closest friends in the congregation said so. Alice should not have treated her as she had. Yet what had Anne done? She had silently seethed. And then she had gathered her supporters around her. But she'd never directly confronted Alice. That was what the scripture clearly said she ought to do. Had she the courage to do that? What if Alice just brushed her off? People often do that when they're confronted with something they did that was wrong. Anne prayed about it. She thought about what she ought to do. She sat down and wrote a letter to Alice so she could put her words exactly as she desired. She told Alice that this had been one of the most painful years of her life in the church. She told Alice that while she had probably not intended to hurt her, she had. For the good of the church, for their own good, she asked if Alice would be willing to meet with her to talk. Well, the short of it is, Alice was willing. The two met over lunch, and there were tears. Alice apologized for the way she had handled things and for the things she had said. Anne took responsibility for what she had done, and they were reconciled. Later, Alice would often say how grateful she was to Anne for taking the initiative, for having the courage to come to her to seek reconciliation. For her part, Anne would say that she did it not so much out of courage, but rather out of love. She loved her church. She even loved Alice, and couldn't bear for things to continue as they had. Now, I know that not every story of division, separation, and hurt goes this way. In today's scripture, Jesus acknowledges that. When we take the initiative and ask for reconciliation, sometimes the offending party agrees, sometimes not. Alice responded graciously and faithfully, but she might not have. And then would Anne have taken the matter before others in the church? Jesus says she should. What is important here is not that the strategy worked, but rather that Anne was faithful. She sought reconciliation. She did so as a Christian who feels a special responsibility for a fellow Christian. And thereby she became an occasion for a fellow Christian to grow in her faith, to be forgiven, to be reconciled. Human nature hasn't changed much in 2,000 years. We still respond to hurts by ignoring them, silently nurturing our wounds, seething in pain and looking for opportunities of revenge, or simply withdrawing in anger and becoming lost. In these verses, Jesus is commanding us to respond differently. And isn't it amazing that he seems to think that we have what we need to be able to reconcile with others? He's not burdening us by suggesting that we reach out and seek to heal those offenses. He's telling us how much faith he has in us, in the early church and in us today. There is a great power in the church. Matthew understood that just as Jesus knew there would be power when he spoke these words. He said, "Whatever we loose or break here on earth in the church will be loosed in heaven. And whatever we are able to put back together here on earth shall be bound together forever in heaven." It reminds us that what happens on earth is parallel to what is happening in heaven. Willimon reminds us, our forgiveness of one another is but a pale reflection of God's forgiveness of us in Jesus. Even when we disobeyed God, and through our disobedience broke our relationship with God, even when we killed God's only son, God took the initiative, came back to us, set things right, and forgave us that the relationship might continue. That's what God wants with you, a reconciled and continuing relationship. So, of course, it's also what God wants for us. Reconciled and lasting relationships which unify us in common cause so we can change lives. When we try to speak truth to another, to offer or receive forgiveness, we are mirroring, in a small way, what God has done for us. We are a foretaste, a dress rehearsal of what is going on in heaven. That's also what is happening at our communion table. We're told it too gives us a foretaste of a heavenly banquet. When we forgive, when we refuse to ignore what has been done, when we humbly confess the wrong we have done and ask to be forgiven, here in our church, we become a corner of heaven. As Jesus said, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." How much more is that true when two or three are brought back together in his name? Amen. Will you join me now in prayer? O God, who is always giving and forgiving, we worship you this day, approaching you with confidence because of your gospel word. We have been forgiven. Because of Jesus, we now know it. And because we have been forgiven, we are to forgive whoever sins against us. We too easily forget. We too soon let your precepts slip from our thoughts. We too readily listen to the advice of the world, urging us to exact revenge, to extract our pound of flesh. This is not your way. This is not according to your word. Forgive them, Jesus prayed, for they know not what they do. Oh God, we are conscientious followers of Jesus. We desire to follow in his way, to walk his walk, and to talk his talk, and to live the life that he desires. But we need your help. We are tempted by the powers that be, pulled this way and that within this earthly plane, to conform to the traditions of the culture, to behave according to the code of the family, to choose allegiance to a lesser God. Protect us and provide for us, that we may stand against the wiles of the world and stand with you in solidarity with the rule of love. Let our relationship with you develop. Let it blossom into ministry and the boldness of profound faith in your power to restore that which has been broken. And let it be lived out where we are, in our personal lives, in the life of our faith community, and to your honor and to your glory. Amen.
Loving God, you make your sun rise on the evil and the good, and send rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. Desiring to love as you love, we make this offering for any who are in need. Use these, our gifts, to build your reign of justice, mercy, and peace upon earth, we pray. Amen.
Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, you are welcome at this table, whether or not you are a member of this church, because this is Christ's table. Anyone who comes to this table is only here because of what he has done for us. So we invite you to find something to represent the body and blood of Christ and join us in this holy meal. Join me now in the great thanksgiving. Let us pray. Lift up your hearts and give thanks to the Lord our God. Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, you made us in your image to love and to be loved. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. By the suffering, death, and resurrection of your only Son, Jesus Christ, you delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Would you join me now in praying the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The bread is a sharing in the body of Christ. Is a sharing in the blood of Christ. We invite you to find whatever you have to hand to share with us in this holy meal now. And those who are gathered with me here will partake as well. Christ shed for me. I take and eat in remembrance and am thankful. Now let us join together in the prayer after communion. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now join us in singing our closing hymn, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all this day and forevermore. Amen.